from the Holy Spirit today. Amen. Verse 1, I'm reading from NKJV. A certain woman of the wives of the sons of the prophets cried out to Elisha, saying, "Your servant, my husband, is dead, and you know that your servant feared the Lord." Who is this woman? Wife of the sons of the prophets, and her husband is a man of God, worked under Elijah, and this man feared the Lord. And the creditor is coming to take my two sons to be his slaves. Verse 2. So Elisha said to her, "What shall I do for you? Tell me, what do you have in the house?" Two questions asked by Elisha in verse 2. Number one question is, "What shall I do for you?" And number two question is, "What do you have in the house?" And she said, "Your maidservant has nothing in the house, but," can somebody say, but a jar of oil. This evening I am here to tell us that we have nothing, but we have the jar of oil in our respective houses. Hallelujah. Verse 3 says, "Then he said, go borrow vessels from everywhere, from all your neighbors." What vessels? Empty vessels. Do not gather just a few. What to borrow? Empty vessels. Not just a few. He didn't say go and borrow oil, because this woman has got the jar of oil in her house. He said go and just borrow empty vessels without oil and collect as many as you can. Verse 4, "And when you have come in, you shall shut the door behind you and your sons, then pour it into all those vessels and set aside the full ones." Why shut the door? Shut out of every distractions and every critic. Being a widow, being in the family of God, there will be a lot of people to criticize her for doing such a strange thing. She is a woman of a man of God, and she is now a widow, and when she go and borrow empty vessels, there will be critics to tease her, criticize her, or there will be people with full of jealousy when they will see the abundance that she is going to receive from borrowing this empty vessel. So shut the door. Set aside the full ones here means fill the vessels one by one. Once one vessel is full, do not stop. As much as you can pour the oil, so much will be your overflowing abundance in the name of Jesus. Amen. Do it one by one, and don't do half in one vessel and half in another vessel. Whatever I am speaking you in brief, we are going to enlarge in the message today. Amen. Verse 5. So she went from him and shut the door behind her and her sons, who brought the vessels to her, and she poured it out. This teaches us to shut the door with like-minded people. Hallelujah. Now verse 6. Now it came to pass when the vessels were full that she said to her son, "Bring me another vessel." And he said to her, "There is not another vessel." So the oil ceased. If more vessels were there, oil will not have ceased. Amen. There is enough oil for you and me this evening if we have enough vessels to fill in. Hallelujah. Verse 7 says, "Then she came and told the man of God, and he said, go, sell the oil and pay your debt." Today we are talking about financial freedom, financial deliverance here in the name of Jesus, including for myself. We speak financial deliverance in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Go, sell the oil, pay your debts, and you and your sons live on the rest. She did not forget the man of God who gave her instructions to get out of her debt. She went back to Elijah.
and she told him what has happened. Amen. The topic that I'm going to share with you today is from lack to overflowing abundance. If you want to call this topic for yourself, say, I'm going to go from my lack to the overflowing abundance today in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father God, for your mighty presence in this place, Lord. You are mighty. You are awesome. You are great. There is no other God besides you. We worship, Lord. You alone are our Savior, Master. There is none, Lord, who is so capable, who is so able, who is so powerful to release us from every bad situation in the name of Jesus, Lord. Father, you alone, we respect, we honor, we adore, we magnify this evening, Lord. No other God. All glory belongs to you, Lord. Lord, as I speak this verse, as I speak the message that you have given me, this message was first given to me, myself, Lord. Lord, I'm still adopting this word in my life to see the deliverance, Master. So, Father, I believe, Lord, as the word goes forth, the deliverance will take place, the release will take place, the chains and fetters will broke in the name of Jesus. This is what I ask of you, Master. Jesus' mighty and matchless and precious name, I pray, and all the saints of God say,
Amen.
So in our scripture reading, the important lesson that Prophet Elijah is teaching this woman and for you and me today is how to live in overflowing abundance. Always, not one day, always. In fact, I've been dwelling on this subject for many months. Still, I would say I'm only trying to understand this portion of scripture, and whatever I have learned so far, that is what I'm going to share with you today. Amen? Because this portion of scripture is talking about one of the family of God's servant who is in debt, who is on the street, who is in the lack. Amen? I mean, a man of God who feared God, family is suffering because of his debts today. Amen? By default, it is natural for you and me to think that the person who is serving God or fearing God, his or her family will be absolute order. Will always be perfect and in absolute order. That is what we all think. Amen? But here, in the story, we see everything is upside down. Amen? The man of God who feared the Lord, the creditors have come threatening to take his two sons to be slaves because of his dead son. Amen? I wonder, if I am the creditor, I would do the same, because Proverbs 22:7 says, the rich rules over the poor and the borrower is servant to the lender. Amen? I would say, according to the scripture, the creditors are doing the right thing by making the children slaves. Another thing, the scripture portion that was troubling me for many months is verse 3. Why Elisha said to this woman to go and borrow? Amen? This woman has come to Elisha for help as she is in need. She is in debt today because of her husband. But Elisha is telling her again to go and borrow. Amen? We have the scripture in the book of Matthew chapter 5 verse 42 which says, give to the one who asks you and do not turn away from the one who wants to borrow from you. Amen? Still, I could not understand why Elisha told her to borrow instead of instantly helping her. Amen? Already she is in debt. I mean, we can understand that this woman has a serious problem. She is troubled and she doesn't know what to do, where to go. Amen? Her problem is she is a widow and her husband was a sole breadwinner of this family. One thing I want to highlight here is there is no vacation for Mr. and Mrs. Problems. Hallelujah. They never take leave. Amen. Problems don't have any annual leaves or casual leaves, not even sick leave they take. Amen. We can take vacation and leave and go to another country, but they always accompany us wherever we go. If you agree with me, then say amen. Because they get free tickets. Amen. To travel anywhere in the world to anybody's house. Without invitation and without any invitation. walk in anyone's life. Amen. You may be matured believer, I may be matured believer, but Mr. and Mrs. problems just enter in any time of your life and my life. That's why in the book of Job it is mentioned in Job 14:1, man who is born of woman is a few days and full of trouble. And I tell you, problems have families too. They are not alone. They too have relatives, and when they come, they bring in along with the relatives to stay in your house or my house. Amen. At one time, we may be facing 2-3 issues, or one after the other, we may be facing. Amen. So Mr. and Mrs. problem, and along with the family members, keep visiting us without permission and invitation. Next, this woman is now under the responsibility to give back to the creditors for the debts the husband has taken. Plus, she has children to whom she needs to take care of, and she has no money. We see this woman is tied up with many problems, plus she has to sacrifice her 2 sons now as slaves to the creditors. No mother would agree that their children would be a slave to anybody. All mothers, lift your hands and say amen. Amen. And thank you for our children, that they are not slaves. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Borrowed money she has, not able to return back, is a social disgrace and shame. If we have borrowed money and we are not able to return back, is a social disgrace and shame. Remember, we are reading about the family, a man who is a servant of God, who fears God, and who has borrowed money, unable to return back now. This is a social stigma here. Amen? Lastly, she had a spiritual disappointment. What is it? Her husband, who believed in God, who served God, who worked all his life for God and his prophets, who feared the Lord according to verse 1 of 2 Kings chapter 4, who lived for God, his family is now on the street. That is called spiritual disappointment, I would say. Amen? When we are in this kind of situation, it is easy to say, God has abandoned me. Amen. Hallelujah. It's very easy to say God has abandoned me. If you remember what Gideon said in Judges 6:13, I liked it very much. Before pinpointing God in Judges 6:13, he is saying, pardon me, my Lord. He's saying, pardon me, my Lord, Gideon says, but if the Lord is with us, why has all this happened to us? His question. Where are all his wonders now that our ancestors told us? About what they said, did not the Lord bring us out of Egypt? There are all those wonders now. But now, he's saying the Lord has abandoned us and given us into the hands of our enemies. That is what Gideon is saying. If I was in that place of that woman, I think I would have also asked the Lord like Gideon, pardon me, O my Lord, but I'm asking you, if I am your daughter, why am I in this situation today? Amen. But for every question of yours and mine, Lord has already word for you and me. Deuteronomy chapter 4 verse 31 says, for the Lord your God is a merciful God. He will not abandon you or me. He will not destroy you or me. He will not forget the covenant which he made to our ancestors, which he confirmed also by an oath. Amen. Hallelujah. So this certain woman has now only one place to go with a problematic situation, to go to her husband's boss, who is the man of God, that is Elisha. So she goes to the boss of her husband, amen, and telling him all her problems. What we need to understand carefully here is, when we go to the prophets to tell our problems, or man and woman of God to tell our problems, we should not imagine that our problems will vanish in a super second. Jimbooba. Problems gone. No, it doesn't happen. It may or may not happen. Sometimes it happens, sometimes it may not. So when we come to God, when we come to the prophets of God, prophetess of God, to tell our problems, there is no magic to get you or me out of our problems immediately. Yes, sometimes it happens, but not always. It is the job of God's servants to always prophesy blessings over anybody coming to them with the problems. Always tell them the word of God, word of blessings, word of promise, what is written in the Bible. We always prophesy to every person. But sometimes it may take a little time for the blessings to come to pass in our lives. Amen? But for sure I tell you this evening in the name of Jesus, it will come to pass. Every word of God in your life and my life will come to pass. Amen? As I told you, for every question of yours and mine, we have a promise from God. 1 Peter chapter 5 verse 10 says, but may the God of all grace, who called you and me to his eternal glory in Christ Jesus, after you and me have suffered a little while, to do what? That suffering comes to perfect you and me, to establish you and me, to strengthen you and me, and to settle you and me to the overflowing repentance forever in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. What happens is we go to someone to tell our problems and we start to expect immediately, hallelujah, that the problems will vanish. So in our scripture reading today in verse 1, this woman goes to Elisha to tell that ready Charles are standing at my door, Elisha, and threatening to take my two sons as slaves. What am I supposed to do? Amen? If I am in that place, I would expect Elisha to put his hand in his pocket and take out some money and give it to me immediately. Amen? Hallelujah? And whatever I need to pay out the debts, I would expect him to give it to me. That is the natural expectation of any person. But in our scripture reading, we see that Elisha did not even pray for this issue. Nor he helped her financially. Amen? His answer to our problems are very different. Philippians 2:4 says, let each of you look out not only for his own interest, but also the interest of others. For the current situation of this woman, if I am there, I would interpret Philippians 2:4 something like this. Elisha is a man who looks for only his interest. Amen? But in reality, Elisha was deeply looking at the interest of this woman so that she is permanently relieved from her lack and reached to overflowing abundance in her life forever. Amen? We will know as we go further in this message. Elisha responded to this woman in most unusual way. He approached this problem of this woman in a different way. Elisha put two questions. Amen. To this woman in verse 2. What shall I do for you? Was the first question Elisha said, ask this woman. Amen. When we take our problems to anyone, if this question comes to you and me, I would say it's a very comforting question. Amen. If I tell Pastor Sam, he will say, what can I do for you, sister? In fact, that was the first prayer when I stood in an amazing grace. First day, I was in a Brahmin background, born in a Brahmin background, and the very first day when I came into AGC and this Sharjah and in another hall, the first question in the altar call, he asked me, what can I do for you, sister? What can I pray for you, sister? Amen. I mean, like, that question is a very comforting question. I would say it's the most satisfying response that we can expect from anybody. Hallelujah. Because this question is focused on what that person can do for you to help. Amen. Elisha could do anything to her. And he put another question to her. What do you have in your house, sister? Amen. It's a strange question, isn't it? Amen. What a person. I mean, when I'm coming to pastor with a problem, first question is acceptable. What is this second question? Amen. For me, it seems to be very strange. She's telling her, I'm in debt. Creditors are standing at the door to take my sons. And you are asking me, what is there in your house? Amen. Woman said, your maidservant has nothing in the house but a jar of oil. If you notice, this woman did not respond to Elisha's first question. He asked her, what shall I do for you? I mean, if I am there again, I'm telling you, I would have told Elisha, see, you have to pay my debts first of all. And then you have to tell me, how do I take care of these two sons? Amen. You have to find a job for me. You have to do this for me. You have to do that for me. But this woman, what I have learned is, she chose not to respond to the first question. And also for respond, I have nothing in the house, the word but, she recalls that she has something in the house. Even though Elisha's approach to the problem is very strange and he did not do what she wants, we have a lesson this evening to take from this woman who did not respond to first question which she could have asked, responded to him. Amen. Hallelujah. I have something in my house. I have a jar of oil. Amen. The solution to our problem was available in her own house, which she could see only when she went to the man or woman of God and told her problems. Amen. Hallelujah. The solution to my problem is in my house. But what I am doing? Oh, Pastor Sammy, Sister Shaku, this is my problem. What can I do? Amen. That is what we are doing. I would like to read one scripture here from the book of Exodus, chapter 9, verse 4. It says, and the Lord will make a difference between the livestock of Israel and the livestock of Egypt. So nothing shall die of all that belongs to you and me.
Yes.
Hallelujah. From this one scripture, I am prophesying that even in our lack, our oil will not die.
Hallelujah, praise the Lord. So what next? It's easy to help people with the
It's not wrong to help, because Bible says in the book of Galatians chapter 6 verse 2, bear one another's burden by fulfilling the law of Christ. Amen. And also Proverbs 19 something says, he who has pity on the poor, doing what? Lending to the Lord. And the Lord will pay him back what he has given to the poor. Amen. And Romans 12 13 says, share with the Lord's people. He is the Lord people only here. Amen. Who are in need. Practice hospitality. Amen. Coming back to our scripture portion of today, the important lesson I learn here is we cannot bring people out of their financial debts forever without teaching them how not to be in debts again.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Teaching for her to overcome permanently from the problems. So what is the answer? This woman realizing suddenly, after saying I don't have anything in her house, but I have a jar of oil. There is a huge difference when you put the word but. It is like saying, Sister Padma, your dress is, everybody told me that my dress is very beautiful today, man. By the way, so my dress is, Padma, your dress is so beautiful. You are looking beautiful today. You are speaking beautiful today. Huh? You do this beautifully today. But you can add anything there. You are looking a little fat today. Amen. You can add anything today. You speak so well and you do pray so well and all those things. But when you put the word but there, you can add whatever you want there. Amen. You can add anything. So the word but here is very powerful. There is so much things behind that word but. Amen. So the word but is a very deep word for me in this portion of scripture. In our scripture portion, this woman lost her husband. She has no money. She is in lack. Creditors are coming to see the children, but she has the oil. Amen. When you say the word but, there is confidence that God is about to bring overflowing abundance in our lives. We should add that much faith to say, I don't have anything but. Here there are people sitting who have attended a lot of interviews but failed. They can still say, I have attended a lot of interviews, I failed, but. Amen. I failed. I have debts to pay, but. Amen. I have a big family to take care of. I am a single mother, but. Amen. My family is in total disorder, but.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I have a lot of sickness in my body to say, I have pain in my heart. I was telling Shaku that my heart keeps paining. I think I have to go for checkup again. But.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I have the oil.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I have lost the job, but I have the oil. Amen. I have the living God. I have the healing, the power of God working in my life. Hallelujah. So introduce that word but into every situation of your life like this woman and increase your hope. Even though we may have big problems, but God has given us that little something through which we can see and we can confess boldly today. We can transform our lack situation to an overflowing abundance in the name of Jesus. Amen. When we go to a prophet or prophetess with our baggage of problems, we must know 3 points that will bring results to permanent relief for your problems. Number one, release the creative word of God.
Amen.
Hallelujah. The woman came to Elisha and Elisha released the creative word of God and told her to borrow empty vessels from everywhere. Our overflowing abundance is actually lying in the creative word of God. Amen. Number two, woman said, I have nothing, but I have a jar of oil. Number one is God's part to release the creative word of God. And then what do we do with that creative word of God, which we receive week after week, midweek after midweek, month after month, year after year? 15 years I've been hearing the word of God in this church. Amen. We Christians are very keen to hear the word of God. We love to hear the word of God. But by just hearing the word of God, we can reach nowhere.
Yes.
We must first bring the oil. Then we have to borrow the vessels, empty vessels, to transform our life from lack to abundance. So first is God's part. Second is our part. Amen. God speaks in many ways to each and every one of us on a regular basis. He gives us the creative word for our will give us the words of wisdom. He will give us the word of knowledge for that particular situation that we are in today. He will give us a prophetic word or rhema word, what you call as a, amen. So the first part is God's part. Second part is your part and my part. Number three, Elisha said, go borrow empty vessels from everywhere. He did not tell her to borrow oil, but only empty vessels. It is easy to borrow oil and then sell that oil and pay off your debts. But God teaches us slowly and steadily and take us through perfectly. Amen? One step at a time. Number one, God's part. Number two, our part. Number three is people's part. What we learn here is, if we have to be overcomer, if we have to come out of all our problems, come out of all our debts, come out of all our lack, to overflowing abundance permanently, we need the creative word of God.
Yeah.
After hearing the word of God, we must take the responsibility to do what God told you to do. Thirdly, unless we are good and wise people around us, unless we know somebody closely, we cannot borrow empty vessels. Amen. Without people, we cannot make it to the end. I will teach you slowly. If time permits, we will complete this message today. If not, we will take next week also. Amen. Proverbs 11:14 says, where there is no counsel, the people follow. But in the multitude of counselors, there is safety. What we are saying here, number three part. We are talking about the part three, amen, people's part. Otherwise, verses such as in Ecclesiastes will not be there in the Bible. Ecclesiastes chapter 4 verse 9 and 10 says, two are better than one because they have a good reward for their labor. And verse 10, for they fall, at least one will lift up.
Yes.
Amen, lift up his companion, but go to him who is alone when he falls, for he has no one to help him out.
Yes.
Amen. So multitude of counselors are very important to you and me. Elisha's part was to release the creative word of God. Hallelujah, which
yes.
He has done. Woman's part was to bring the jar of oil from our house and borrow empty vessels from the people. There is a part that God plays, but there is a part that you and me have to play. And there is a part that people play in your life and my life. If we mix all this together, we will enter into overflowing abundance in our
yes.
lives. Amen? So every time when we are in crisis, we must understand these three keys and apply appropriately. We will see our lack turning to overflowing abundance always. Amen? So what Elisha is teaching this woman, I would say Elisha is teaching this woman financial independence.
Yes.
Amen? Hallelujah? So we are learning today the financial independence from the Holy Spirit. This is more for me, if not for you, definitely for me. Amen. Hallelujah. We cannot survive just with some financial support by somebody at the time of crisis. If we want to live in overflowing abundance always, then first we need the creative word. We need the divine wisdom. We need the divine understanding. We need the divine chastisement. We need the divine discipline. And we need the divine direction. Amen. Hearing that creative word alone cannot solve our problem. We need to act on the word. After hearing the word, we need to bring that available oil and borrowed empty vessel and bring it on the table for overflowing abundance. We cannot sleep just because God said he will give us a job. You ask the people who are jobless in our church and ask them how they are working on it. Amen. Just God has already prophesied over the life that you will not be in lack. You will get your job.
Yeah.
You will get your promotion.
Yeah.
You will get your healing.
Yeah.
You will get your finances.
Yeah.
Everything prophecy is already done. But what they are doing after receiving that prophecy, you
yes.
have to go and ask them and they will tell you what they are doing. Amen.
Yeah.
We need to do our part with the oil. When God speaks his part, he is just showing you, he is pushing you towards your divine destiny. When he speaks, amen, he is just telling you the miraculous line here, Padma, go and take it.
Yes.
But to go and take it is my job. Amen,
yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
If we just keep sitting and hearing the word of God and the miracle will happen, then we all just sit in this room only and keep on hearing the word of God by one, all of us can come and stand here and speak the word. Amen, hallelujah, praise the Lord. So receiving the word of God alone will not help our problems. I'm talking very practically. Please forgive me if you have heard by saying like this, amen. If we receive the word, then we have to bring the oil and the empty vessels. And then there are other people you have to involve wisely so that you get the speedy results and overflowing abundance.
Yeah.
Amen. Hallelujah. Today I came to tell you that your problem is solved, not solved just by speaking the word of God. Amen. After the word is spoken, you have to do your part. I have to do my part. Amen. So component number one originates from God. Hallelujah. God's words helps us to construct our life, our destiny. Amen. Word has the creative power. Hallelujah. Word only start the process of miracle. Unless we join that path and complete it, the overthrowing abundance will never come. Amen. Hallelujah. The word can only shake you, as Benjamin said, shake. Yeah, the word can only shake you and me and push us to our destiny. Hallelujah. So for example, today I was told to preach. That is God's covenant. Amen. God's part to ordain me to preach today. Now the second component is my part. After hearing the creative word, Padma, you have to preach today. What is my job? I have to go and meditate on the word of God. I have to sit with the God of the Bible. Amen. So that I can stand here today and minister to you. Without doing that, if I come here, I cannot preach. I cannot teach. Amen. Even Pastor Sam, who is ministering for ages now. Amen. You ask him, he still has to go separate himself and sit with God, so that he can minister week after week. Hallelujah. So God's part is to call us to do something. Our part is to go and work on that something. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
So without which I cannot preach. So my part is there. What is people's part in my preaching today? I am filling the empty vessels with the oil that God has given me to say. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Now do you believe that there is oil in your house today? Amen. I believe that there is oil in your house. Otherwise, a woman who is born in a Brahmin background family, if God has not touched me and filled me with his oil, I cannot stand here and minister to you. Amen. Hallelujah. So I have something. Amen. If God has created you and me and made us fearfully and wonderfully and created us from before the foundation of the world, then he has definitely kept some oil for you and me. Hallelujah. Leave it today. We may think that I am useless. I am nothing. I can do nothing. But, use the word but.
Amen.
Let me elaborate further. Suppose there are two or more children in your house, and all that, one must be always silent. Outwardly like David, shepherd boy. Amen. We may be thinking about that child that he or she do not have the capacity or the potential like the other one whom we think has all the potential. But one day, this shepherd boy child whom we consider as weak and don't know anything comes out so shiningly to our amazement like King David. What does it mean? God has kept a jar of oil in every one of us.
Yes.
Amen. We heard a lot of things in the morning from Pastor Bill. Yeah? We know the jar of oil was kept for him. That's why he has reached to this level today.
Yes.
Amen. If we operate with that oil that he has kept for you and me, we will reach the overflowing abundance one day. So God gave the creative word. Woman brought the oil, and that oil brought her to the overflowing abundance in her life. The little jar of oil has all the strength, all the advantage in your life and my life.
Yes.
If you agree with me, say amen.
Amen.
I mean, it sets, sets you and me apart from others. And it gives us an edge of protection. That oil gives us an edge of protection.
Amen.
Every person sitting here, whether young or old, infant or very old, or school going or college going, or working or doing the domestic house, amen, God has kept that jar of oil for you. Amen. Hallelujah. Our jar of oil is what for advantage that God has given to you and me. So today, if you know what is that gift, what is that advantage, Amen. Let us not live without knowing about the jar of oil which is in our own house to solve all our problems. Amen. After discovering the oil, position it, process it, position it. You must act on it. You must use it. When we position our oil and start using it, we will be able to pay all our debts. We will be able to pay all our debts. Amen. Before I close, let me talk to you regarding the vessel part. Vessels are only the container, but oil is the creative part.
Yes.
Amen. Which I will call it as your anointing, your calling, your gifts, your talents, your knowledge, your wisdom, etc., etc. Amen. We learn Elisha is bringing a process of change in this woman to telling her to borrow empty vessels. What does it mean? Why vessels when they are? I mean, vessels were very limited also. The portion of scriptures we are reading, there is no another vessel, so the oil seals in verse 6. Amen? Why vessel or container when it is very limited? We need more empty vessels. Plenty of oil is already available. What is borrowed vessels? As I told you, I was struggling to understand what is borrowed vessels. Learning methods and ideas of other wise people is reflected here as borrowed vessels. Amen? But, I mean, oil should be your own, but you borrow the ideas and methods of other people, that is called borrowed vessels. Amen? I cannot become like you, you cannot become like me. Amen? I mean, let us take the example of this morning service. I interviewed the man of God. What we were learning about him and his ministry. Basically, we were borrowing his tactics, we were borrowing his methods, we were borrowing his ideas, and we were learning how he did it all and reached to this level of overflowing abundance.
Yeah.
Amen? That is what this woman is called to do, to borrow the vessels. That is what Elisha is telling this woman in our scripture reading today, to borrow the ideas, to borrow the methods, to borrow the knowledge, but the oil should be your house. Amen? I don't need to walk like other women or men. You don't like to walk like me, or you don't like to stand like me. Amen? I just adopt the method that you use and apply and mix it with the oil that God has placed in my life. And when both goes together, I see the overflowing abundance in my life. Amen? Hallelujah? So we are supposed to be what we are called to be, what we are ordained to be. Amen? We don't need to be number two of any anointed men or women of God. We have to be number one of our own selves.
Yes.
Amen? As we become number one with that little oil, jar of oil, which is available in our house, and by bringing empty vessels and pouring the oil, when these two mix us, then we become number one. Amen? Hallelujah? I mean, the very first day, if somebody has to stand here and preach, that person may or may not be able to preach. By seeing other people preaching, by seeing what Pastor Sam is doing in the services, we all grew, we all learned. Amen? By seeing the methods, by seeing the tactics, we all grew. Amen? That is what we did. That's why Elisha told the woman not to borrow the oil, but to borrow the empty vessels. Amen? Borrowed empty vessels, what it does, it increases the value of what you already have. Amen? As we keep pouring the oil in the borrowed empty vessels, the value increases. Amen? Borrow from every field, I would say. Borrow from science. Borrow from IT team. Borrow from the worship team. Borrow from accountants. Borrow from equipment team. Borrow from tea team. Every team, we must borrow. That is how we are now overflowing abundance here. Amen? We have to borrow from every field. Even Jesus did borrow from every field. If you read the word of God in most of the gospels, he's explaining you and me the word of God through agriculture. What he was doing, I mean, he was telling you, guys, borrow from agriculture, learn from that. Amen? That is what he was teaching us. So, meaning Jesus also taking from other field of lives and telling us the word of God. How to take from every field, there is something he has created in every one of us. That is what I mean to say. He has put something in every one of us, and we have to just take that something from that person. Amen? Hallelujah? And when this woman went to borrow the vessels, she would have met a lot of different kinds of people. Some house may be poor, some house may be rich, some house may be architect's house, some house may be artist's house like Vasu. are not learning moral systems, moral methods, moral ideas, moral tactics. Amen. If we have to have overflowing abundance, then we need the help of different people as well. Read the biography of all the big pastors in the church history. When Ian will do his next NCU, he has to do church history. In the church history course, what we basically learn is what Martin Luther did. How did he develop the church to this big? We learn from all the big people who had big churches or who brought the gospel to the nations, how they worked. These are all the things that we will learn in church history now. Amen. So borrow knowledge. Amen. Why? I mean, this morning Pastor Bill taught us to find opportunities to be around the man of God. To do what? To borrow knowledge from the man of God. Amen. That is what I understood when he said, find opportunities to be the around the man of God. Why we have to be around the man or woman of God? To find knowledge. Amen. Aline, if you go to Aline, I have quoted one example here for Aline also. I mean, no doctor can give you that medication what Aline can give. Amen. If you go to Aline and say that Aline, I'm sick for 2-3 days, this cough is not going, this fever is not going, tell me what do I do? She will give you one big list.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Why? How she knows all these things? Because she borrowed the knowledge from science. She borrowed, as Pastor Bill said, when doctor can do, you cannot do like that. Borrow knowledge from your doctors. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. And learn how to repay your debts by your own self. Not from Elisha, not from that borrowed oil or anything. I mean, you learn the tactics. Now you have the oil. Now you learn, I mean, you do marketing of that oil. That is what she is doing here. Elisha did not give her any money, but he taught her the way so that she will never be in lack, but always in overflowing abundance. So I pray that the jar of your oil and my oil and the borrowed empty vessel meet the creative power of the word of God in your life and my life to see the Lord. Amen. There are something to note while borrowing the vessels. It should not have hole in it. Otherwise, the oil will leak. Amen. Hallelujah. Bible says in Proverbs 21:20, it is not there. There is precious treasure and oil in the dwelling of the wise, but a foolish man swallows it up all. Amen. So see to it that there is no leak. Hallelujah. Not every method is clean. So you cannot pour oil into the vessel which is unclean. So you have to borrow the vessel which is clean. I mean, I will give you one example for this. We see a lot of rich people around the world, around the church also. And some may have gained that wealth through wrong means. Don't borrow the good. Amen. That is why I am saying don't borrow unclean vessels. Borrow the clean vessels which is only given for the honor of God. Amen. So we are supposed to borrow vessels which is doesn't have the hole. Pastor Bill gave one example this morning about one American woman learning Hindi and having ministry in Mumbai, India. Pastor Bill also said for the institution, any institution to accept you and me, we have to have their way of language. Amen? Yeah. What is that? This American woman heard the creative word first. There is something in her, that is the jar of oil in her, and then she borrowed empty vessel to learn Hindi, and God gave the overflowing abundance. That's why she is having that ministry in India today. Amen? That is the overflowing abundance, and I'm sure that she is not in debt today of any sort. Amen? So that is what you and me are supposed to do. Pastor Bill also said this morning, we should not put the little things that God put our way. Big doors open through small little things that God brings our way. That is what he said this morning. So from that little jar of oil, the woman in our scripture reading saw an overflowing abundance. She did not become rich and pay the debts overnight. She first had that little jar of oil and then mixed with the borrowed vessels, then she saw the overflowing abundance. So one important point to be noted from Pastor mean God has blessed him with that. When that man picked him up, that was a clean vessel that God has put him in. That is why we are seeing an overflowing abundance in the life of Pastor Bill today. Amen. Hallelujah. So these are all the things. And then we have to see whether that vessel has got the strength to hold your oil.
Yes.
The oil that you take, whether that, I put an example here. I mean, what I mean to say is the system should be very strong. If I tell you the example, then you may understand. If you all remember, apart from the United States of America, we used to call Russia as USSR. If you all remember, once upon a time when we were reading history and geography in our school days, both were similarly strong once upon a time. But today, there is no USSR. Because all the states of Russia are now separated. Why I compare and give you this example is to say that our system should be so strong enough that we'll be able to stand for long and live in overflowing abundance. Amen? USSR was much bigger than the United States of America. But again, the word but, the system, the method about adopted by USSR was not strong enough, hence broken today. Amen? So borrow empty vessels without holes. No unclean vessels can be borrowed. And the vessel that you borrow should be strong enough to take you to an overflowing abundance. Now we will see the shape and size of the borrowed empty vessels. Borrowed empty vessels will be of different shapes and different sizes. When we pour in the oil in the borrowed vessels of different shapes and different sizes, what will happen? I have a little oil to teach the word. When I read the word and hear the word, I will grow in teaching the word. Amen? According to the shape and size of that vessel. I mean to say, I have a oil, I am reading the word. I mean, according to the time I associate with the word of God, I learn that word. According to the shapes and sizes, I have put like how much time or how much I spend my time with the Lord to learn that word. That is what I put here. Elisha said like this in verse 4 of 2 Kings. Verse 4, he says, shut the door. What I said is very important instructions to shut the door. I told you, this woman was a widow woman. Amen. There will be a lot of unrequired and unwanted people. I mean, they should not see what she is doing. I mean, when you are from your lap going to your abundance, there will be a lot of critics on your way. Especially when you are a woman of God and the people around you are not even knowing who is Jesus. And when you adopt certain ways, it will be strange for them. They will, as Pastor Bill said, what we are doing may be crazy for them. What David Livingstone did was like a nut for other people. So when you and me are doing something to go from our lack to overflowing abundance, the things what you and me are doing may be crazy for somebody.
Yes.
That is why we should shut the door of every distraction, shut the door of every jealousy, shut the door and only have like-minded people in your house.
Yes.
That is why Elisha is teaching her to keep your two sons inside and nobody else. Which means what? Just keep like-minded people so that you are going to your overflowing abundance is not distracted by any other means.
Yes.
Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. This is what I have prepared for teaching all of us today this evening. Can I request the choir team to come here as I continue to speak so that they can sing the same songs what we sang in the morning. Amen. After the word. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. So Pastor Bill also said, when you do something unusual for God, everybody thinks that we are crazy and not sorry. Amen. If you're going to walk into overflowing abundance, carefully choose your vessels. Not a vessel with hole, not an unclean vessel, not a vessel that doesn't have the strength, and then shut the door, shut out of every distractions, and focus on the task to complete it, so that you pay your debts today. Amen. Keep like-minded people with you. And then what this woman is doing in our story today is she's going back to the prophet to tell her that, see, man of God, what you told I have done, now I am finished with the vessels, but my oil has not finished. So always have gratitude. salvation to hear today. Amen. That is what she did. And then lastly, he says that first prayer, first listen to God and pay to God first. And then go and pay your debts. And then live with the rest for your life. Amen. So when we are getting that overflowing abundance, we should pay to God first. And then we should pay off our debts. And then with the rest, we should live our entire life. That is what verse 7 teaches us this evening. Amen. Hallelujah. Can we all rise up as Benjamin is again going to lead us with a song? I'm sure that this teaching has helped me, and I'm sure that it has helped you too. I'm sure if it has helped you, I'm sure that you are going to apply this teaching and apply these measures so that none of us are in any kind of debt this evening. That is what is my prayer this evening. Lord, I speak financial deliverance for every one of us in this place in the name of Jesus, Lord.
Yes.
Father, if any one of us is stuck in any problem like this widow woman, Lord, not to know where to go, what to do, Father, in your presence, Lord, touch them. In your presence, Lord, give them direction today. In your presence, Lord, as they lift their hands and pray to you, Master, Lord, speak to their hearts. Give them that creative, powerful word for the situation today in the name of Jesus, Lord. Give them that strength that they will go back and apply that creative word and work on it, Master. Show them that little jar of oil which is available in their own house today, Master. That is what we ask of you, Lord. Show them that jar of little oil which is available in their own house, Master. Show them which vessel, empty vessel, to bring in, Master. To go into overflowing abundance, Lord. That's what we ask of you, Father. We thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, mighty God. Keep worshiping the Lord as the song goes by.
Lord, that you will bless me indeed and enlarge my territory, that your hand will be with me, that you will keep my heart for me.
Prosperity is part of salvation. Wealth is part of salvation. Jesus became poor so that we will be rich in Him. The Bible says, you shall not want. The Lord is my shepherd, and I shall not want. He's the God of your needs, He's the God of your wants, and He's the God of your desires. The Bible says in 37, 3 and 4 of Psalm, delight in the Lord also, and He will grant you the desires of your heart. Commit your ways unto the Lord, and He shall establish your paths. That's what the Word of God says. And my dear brothers and sisters, as the Word has come to us, there must be no lack in the house, and in your homes, in your lives. No spiritual lack, no physical lack, no financial lack. Let your oil overflow. Let your oil overflow. Let your oil overflow. The Bible says, Jesus said in John 7, he who believes in me, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. Psalmist David says in Psalm 23, he has anointed my head with oil, my cup runneth over. The Bible says in Proverbs chapter 3, 9 and 10, honor the Lord with your substance and with all the first fruits of your increase. So shall your barns will overflow with plenty, and your presses will burst out with new wine. My dear brothers and sisters, these are the promises of God, and we need to hedge those promises in our heart. And do not let enemies steal it. Jesus said the devil comes to steal, to kill and to destroy. But I have come that you will have life and life more in abundance. Our God is the God of abundance in every arena of your life. There is no lack in the house of God. I declare it and decree it upon your lives. In the mighty name of Jesus, no lack in your life, no lack in your marriage, no lack in your family, no lack in your business, no lack in your job, no lack in your finances, no lack for your future. The plans that I have for you is to bless you, not to visit you with evil, but to give you a hope, to give you an expected end, to give you a future. The plans of Jesus is insurmountable. The thoughts of Him towards you is only to do you good. He's your Abba Father. He doesn't want to see you burdened under debt. And therefore I destroy that burden of debt from the house of God in the mighty name of Jesus. I speak abundance over your life. I speak abundance in your oil. I speak abundance in your competence. I speak abundance in your influence. I speak abundance in your finances. I speak abundance in the gifts of the Holy Spirit. I speak abundance in the fruit of the Holy Ghost. That the anointing of God will multiply over your life. I speak abundance of the Holy Ghost upon your life. Come on, take it in the name of Jesus. Take the abundance in the mighty name of Jesus. Take the anointing of God in the mighty name of Jesus. He hung naked on the cross so that your nakedness will be covered. He was rejected so that you will be accepted in the beloved. He was disowned so that you will be adopted in the kingdom of Yeshua the Messiah. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? He was forsaken so that you will not be forsaken, so that you will not be forgotten, that you will be adopted into the kingdom of Yeshua. Tonight is your inheritance. You have a great inheritance. The Lord God Jehovah Almighty is your inheritance. The God of Abraham is your inheritance. The God of Jacob is your inheritance. The God of Israel is your inheritance. The God of Isaac is your inheritance. You've got a great inheritance, church. The Lord of Sabaoth, the God of war, is your inheritance. He says, I'll go before you. I will level every mountain for you, raise up every valley for you, create an even path for you to walk on, cut the gates of iron and bronze for you, and give you the hidden treasures of darkness and the riches that are stored in secret places, so that the name of Yeshua will be glorified.
The Bible says in the book of Psalm 46:10, be still and know that I am your God. Be still and know that I am your God. He is your God. He will deliver you. He will rescue you. He will liberate you. He will cause you to walk in absolute freedom that comes forth from the Jehovah God Almighty. It is the anointing of the oil that sets the captives free. It is the anointing of the Holy Ghost that is inside of you. Stir it up. Span it up. And let it become a wildfire. Father, we want to say thank you. We receive your word of God. Father, we pray, Lord, that there will be, oh Lord, an overabundance of your flow in our lives, oh God, of your visions, of your power, of your anointing, of your oil of the Holy Spirit, oh God, of the love of Jesus, of the light of Jesus, of the life of Jesus, oh God. There'll be an overabundance of everything, oh God. The Lord, your church will lack no good thing, oh God. Lord, I release your blessings upon your church. Your church will be blessed, will thrive, will flourish, and will prosper. Bless your handmaiden with God as she brought your word with us, that you will enlarge her territory, increase her borders. Her family that comes from a Brahmin background will be saved in Jesus' name. Her son will dance for Jesus, sing for Jesus, oh God. Lord, we declare and decree salvation. We send salvation, oh God, into his heart, into his mind, into his spirit right now in the name of Jesus. And I speak your blessings upon the congregation. The congregation will be blessed. The work of the hands will be blessed. The businesses will be blessed. The jobs will be blessed. The marriages will be blessed. The families will be blessed. The children will be blessed. Every single person in the house of God will be blessed for God. Let Jesus be alone, glory. We thank you, we bless you, and we give you the praise. In Jesus' most holy, mighty, and matchless name we pray. And the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of the Father, and the fellowship of his sweet Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. And all of us said, amen. Amen. God bless you. Hallelujah. Shabbat shalom to you. Have a good evening. God bless you. Have a good night. We'll see you again next week in the West Scholars in Dubai. But our little angels are going to run the service of the first half, and you will come and thoroughly enjoy yourself. God bless you. God be with you. Good night. Meet one another. Greet one another. And God bless you. Thank you.